Hello, everybody, and welcome to this month's free preview of our What a Cartoon Movie podcast about Aladdin. It's me, Bob Mackey, and if I had one wish, I'd wish for our longest podcast ever.
Hey, it's Henry Gilbert, and don't you dare close your eyes.
I have to leave them open when I'm podcasting, Henry. So yes, welcome once again to another free preview of the What a Cartoon Movie podcast. And in case you're like, what is this doing in my feed? Well, I'll tell you, mister, this is a free preview of what you'll get if you sign up for our $10 tier at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. At that level, along with all the $5 rewards, like all of our exclusive miniseries, end of season wrap-ups and so on, over, I don't know, hundreds of podcasts. At this point, you'll also have access to the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, where you go into a different cartoon movie every month. And this month it's Aladdin, and it is our longest podcast to date. It's not been edited, but we have over 4 hours of recording.
Yes.
So we could safely say you're going to sign up for 4 hours worth of Aladdin chat if you sign up for that $10 level. And also, yeah, you'll get what, five or six other movie length podcasts?
Oh,
and everyone
seven
in the
at
future.
This point.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow. It's been a while.
No, yes, you get a ton for your $10 a month, and we make it totally worth your while. On this one, me and Bob were total millennials geeking out about our favorite Disney Renaissance film. We talk a ton about the many creators and brilliant people behind this. We talk about its popularity. We talk about Robin Williams' problems with Disney. And we go scene by scene through the film and celebrate each little amazing drawing that you will find throughout the movie. Like, we cover it all, baby. And all the songs, like, god damn, the songs are the greatest.
Yes, yeah. And we just recorded it, so yes, it's been a lot of talking. But in this free preview, you will hear a bit of the history of the movie and how it went through several different forms until it became the Aladdin that you know and hopefully love. Mm-hmm. And the part that you won't hear is even more history and our scene-by-scene discussion of Aladdin. But again, if you sign up at the $10 level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, you can hear the whole thing and every other What a Cartoon Movie podcast we did and all the ones we'll do in the future.
Yeah. And in case you're totally brand new and don't know what those are, you'd have in store Batman Mask of the Phantasm, Kiki's Delivery Service, Akira, A Goofy Movie, The Secret of Nim, and Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. All six of those. 20 hours of podcast right there of me and Bob going super in-depth into all of those classic animated features. We love doing them all, and we think it is totally worth it. And each month, we have another one chosen by our patrons, and you can help us pick if you are a $10 and up patron as well. So consider signing up or upping your current pledge to $10. It's really easy to do. And also, you'll get access to all of our premium video content that we did before the What a Cartoon Movies. Let me tell you, as Jasmine would say, every moment's red letter.
Wow, she did say that. So yes, you'll have frankly too much content, but we hope you enjoy all of it, especially our new Aladdin podcast. And stay tuned for a brief portion of our discussion of Aladdin's really, really in-depth history. This all goes back to the late Howard Ashman. So in 1988, Howard Ashman, who was then working with his partner Alan Menken on The Little Mermaid, pitched Aladdin. I believe it was pitched as a 40-page treatment. He provided six songs, and three of those songs were used in the final film. So One Jump Ahead was used. I believe the melody was used, but the lyrics were different.
Tim Rice redid the lyrics. Yeah.
Prince Ali and Never Had a Friend Like Me. Those are three of Howard Ashman's songs that are in the final product.
Yeah, the Ashman is such an important part of the Disney legacy we know. Like, there's... It's hard to overstate how much he helped them find their way again after the bad times of the 80s. Like, he really, they wouldn't be anywhere without him. It's, and there's this great, actually, if I can play the clip now.
Oh, sure.
The movie Waking Sleeping Beauty is just a great documentary in general about Disney becoming into its own again as feature animation at a time when they even thought they might never animate another feature film again. And this clip here is about how Ashman really helped reignite that and find what the spirit of those films would be as musicals. And so this clip here is a number of animators who were working with Ashman at the time when they first met him explaining to them what musicals are and the importance of them.
And Howard comes in and says, no, you don't understand. Telling stories with music is central to what Disney is. And here's how you do it.
Howard kind of introduced us to his way of thinking. Howard Ashman brought our entire staff into the little feature animation theater on Flower Street, which was very tiny, and we all fit in it because there weren't very many of us. And he did kind of an oral history of the evolution of the American musical and the evolution of the Disney animated film. He sort of did these two parallel tracks and showed how they intertwined.
I'm really a musical theater person, and I do see a very, very strong connection between these two media.
And that last clip was Ashman there talking about how he sees the connection. Like, it's something, you know, I think for most Americans and especially mainstream, they think of like musicals as these big, gaudy Broadway things that are just like upper crust distractions, like silly things. But they don't think of movies like Snow White or Cinderella as musicals, even though they are in all the ways that matter. They're just animated as that. And him taking the animators through that history let them really understand what they were making so much better than they did before when they were working on stuff like Black Cauldron.
And with The Little Mermaid, he created the model for the Disney musical. And it's important to note that Ashman came from off-Broadway, and his biggest hit at the time was Little Shop of Horrors. I think that's personally my favorite musical.
I haven't even seen
that many musicals, to be fair, but I love the music in that so, so much.
Every moment of that is great. And I had forgotten that component of it. You know, Seymour and Aladdin have a lot in common, actually.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
What is it? Skid Row and a street rat together.
Oh, wow. That's true. He's not a flower shop worker. He's just a bum. So yeah. same thing, kind of.
Also an orphan.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Wow. A lot is in common here. But so Howard Ashman, Aladdin is his baby, or it was his baby. It's important to note also that he played Aladdin in a 1965 Children's Theater Association production of the classic story.
Oh, I didn't know
so that. So Aladdin was in his bones, and that was his baby. But unfortunately, he was pulled away from it to work on Beauty and the Beast because at some point in its production history, Beauty and the Beast did not have songs.
Mm.
And it was not doing well. So they're like, let's get Song Guy to write songs for us. Come here, Song Guy. And
I can't imagine that movie without songs. That's crazy.
I can't either. And maybe we'll do it one day in the future, but I don't know the production history of that movie. But at some point, it did not have songs. So like I said before, three of his songs remain in the finished film. One of the important components of this backstory is, this is very sad, by the way. This is a lot of being choked up while doing research. Howard Ashman died of AIDS in 1991.
Yep.
At age, I think, 40.
Yeah, there's a really great article on just his whole life story out there that's about how, like, he was with the same man for most of his life.
Yeah.
Like, functionally his husband, obviously not legally.
Yeah.
But yeah.
It's on Vice. It's called Beauty and the Plague.
That's the one, yeah.
And he has his own website where you can read. His sister has done a really good job of, like, collecting his history. It's howardashman.com.
Yeah. No, and it's just so sad, especially, like, now we're... at least if you can afford the medicine, AIDS is a more treatable disease now, but that's even in 91, he was right on the cusp of him being able to survive something like that. And he's just, you see him in pictures and he's like, he's a skinny guy. He doesn't look like the picture of health even in the 80s.
Yeah.
But you can see so much energy in his work. And I believe it was, he had just passed away when the Oscars were coming for Beauty and the Beast because everybody was wearing their AIDS ribbons to remember him.
Yeah. At that point in time, AIDS was like a death sentence, basically. Like, you have AIDS, you're going to die at some point. And I believe, like, he had AIDS and didn't know it during The Little Mermaid, but it was during the production of Beauty and the Beast that he found out. And he basically had to do, and like, and he was very, like, when he found out he had the virus, he was already dying. He was like, didn't have very long to go. And by the time Beauty and the Beast was in production, he was doing the work from his deathbed. Like, not to bring everybody down, but the tragedy of his life is very important to the movies that he helped make. So when he was dying, he was working on Beauty and the Beast and Aladdin. And he didn't see either movie's release, I think.
No, I don't think so. Well, I mean, it's just so sad, too, because, like, he loved it. Like, they make a point in that video as well about how, like, he was offered anything. Like, Disney was like, you want to work with us on this? Work with us on this live-action thing. Or help us adapt the Tina Turner book into What's Love Got to Do with It. And he's like, I want to do the cartoons. Animation is where I want to go. Like, he chose that out of all things. So, I mean, he was working on it by choice from his deathbed because he knew those songs would live on forever. Like, those are eternal songs no matter when he was going to pass away. So, yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, you don't need me, like a straight guy, to lecture people about the AIDS epidemic, but it's just shocking if you go back and look at how it was ignored. And I mean, number one, not to be crass or anything, but like, number one, the most important thing that we lost are people.
Yes.
But number two, we lost so much potential great works of art mm-hmm. because the people that could have made it all died. Like,
they're all dead.
Who knows what Ashman could have done in the after Beauty and the Beast and Aladdin? Like, who knows like what more great works he could have created?
Mm-hmm. Into nine, and that's just one person. Now, that lifetime of works, decades of work stolen from us by that. Imagine that times millions, and yeah. that's what you lost.
Like, yeah, you could thank Ronald Reagan and his buddies. Yeah. Some of which are still floating around in politics. So.
It's wonderful. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, why punish them? No. And it, I mean, that's, I think we'll actually talk about Lindsay Ellis more here, but,
For sure. Yeah.
Lindsay Ellis, the YouTube essayist, she has a very good video on Rent, the movie version of the musical, and how it's kind of crass and really doesn't understand what the AIDS epidemic was. And she has some, she collects and contextualizes some amazing footage of protests and just the anger of like, this is a plague. They are killing us all. It is mass murder through disinformation. And it's like, it makes me upset every time I think about it. It's honestly too awful.
Yeah. So again, that is just part of the backstory of this movie. Not to bring anybody
down.
That's
Howard Ashman. Yes.
Yeah. That's Howard Ashman. He died. He lived a tragic life, but he created some great stuff in 40 years. But his initial treatment of Aladdin, it was a 40-page treatment with the 6 songs we talked about. And he envisioned it as a 30-style musical with a Cab Calloway-esque genie. So think Oogie Boogie in Nightmare Before Christmas is sort of the same character.
Okay.
Like a kind of randy, you know, jazzy kind of guy.
Mm. That makes Friend Like Me as a song. I can totally hear it sung in that style, too, instead of just full of voice impressions instead, yeah. Which I think is how more it's played in the Broadway versions of the show.
Oh, for sure. Like, I was listening to the Broadway version of Friend Like Me, and it is way more Cab Calloway. Like, Robin Williams lapses into a Cab Calloway impression a few times, but he mostly jumps around between impressions in that song. But if you listen to Ashman's songs that were left in the movie, they all sound like of that same soundscape, like the bum, ba ba bum, ba ba bum. Mm-hmm. Like, Friend Like Me and Prince Ali and One Step Ahead, it's just like the rousing, like, kind of boogie-woogie beat. Mm-hmm. That Ashman wanted for his version of Aladdin.
Though then that makes the film's musical theming almost kind of like two personalities through unfortunate reasons for that, but yeah.
Yeah, the other two songs are good, but they are sort of off tone compared to Ashman songs in the
yeah.
movie.
Yeah, I mean, they're more like the gaudy 80s musicals that came before it, like Phantom or Les Mis, just like sweeping themes, big statements. And I mean, that is what you hire Andrew Lloyd Webber's lyricist for.
Oh, that's
like,
where he came from. Yeah.
Tim Rice. Yeah, that's what
Jesus
you get.
Christ Superstar and mm-hmm. stuff? Okay, that's what
that
I thought.
That was his big one, yeah.
So the director, one of the directors of Aladdin, John Musker, we'll talk more about him later, he said Ashman had a rule of, quote, never go slow if you can go fast, unquote, and then, quote, never go white if you can go black. And Ashman preferred the energy and power of black voices, which explains things like why Audrey 2 in Little Shop is a black character and why the Greek chorus are black soul singers.
Okay, that yeah. totally makes sense. Yeah.
And it was kind of cute. Like, there's an aside by his sister when he's quoted, and she's like, I don't know if we should leave this in, but he really liked black performers. And I know this sounds weird, but he meant it in the nicest way.
Yeah, you know, I guess it does seem a little loaded as like, but it's a positive stereotype, but it is like, though, again, in the 80s, on a feature level, who was giving black performers that many opportunities, you know? And so by that, I mean, the soul of Little Shop of Horrors is an African-American like musical style and voice, like the Greek chorus in that, which they totally just rip off for Hercules. Like,
that's totally true. Yeah.
Which is great. I love yeah. those singers in that too. So I'm not saying it was bad. They did that in Disney's Hercules, but those singers, like, that was, it also, it introduced me to Motown and that style. Like, I didn't know that music, but I watched Little Shop of Horrors 8 million times as a kid because we taped it off HBO, and I loved the puppet. The puppet was awesome, and all the songs were amazing.
And because we do Talking Simpsons, we should note that the off-Broadway voice of Audrey 2 was Ron Taylor, Bleeding Ems Murphy.
That's right.
Not the voice in the movie. That yeah. was Levi Stubbs mm-hmm. of the Four Tops, but they're both very good voices. So what happened to this treatment of Ashman's? Well, Linda Wolverton, she was the writer of Beauty and the Beast, the future co-writer of Aladdin, and the only woman credited as the sole writer of a $1 billion movie. I'm going to ask you, Henry, which movie is that? $1 billion movie.
$1 billion movie.
Not Tim and Eric's.
Okay.
But she's the sole writer. It's a Disney movie.
Okay, I got to guess Disney. Then let's go Tarzan.
No.
Wait, that didn't make $1 billion.
It's a movie that I don't think anyone has seen, but it's made $1 billion. Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, of course. Yeah. If you said nobody's seen it, I was like, okay. The Alice in Wonderland.
I guess China saw it is what I'm saying.
I was just looking at it on the list of rankings of box office for Disney remakes and to see where Aladdin currently falls in that. And just seeing it there, it's like, oh yeah, there was that Alice in Wonderland movie.
There's a sequel?
Yes, yeah, which apparently is even worse.
It's weird. So yes, this treatment that she provided, the screenplay, used some of Ashman's ideas, but also a lot of influence from the 1940 film, The Thief of Baghdad.
Mm-hmm. Baghdad is the real name of Agrabah.
Yes.
Like that's, but we were kind of bombing Baghdad at the start, so let's change it to Agrabah.
That is true. Yeah, they just changed the name. So this is now the second version of Aladdin. So the first version is Ashman's treatment, not a complete version, but a treatment of a story. Mm-hmm. The second version is Linda Wolverton's screenplay. The third version is when directors Ron Clements and John Musker enter the production, and they basically make a third version of this story. While they change around some of Wolverton's ideas and have their own takes on Ashman's and Menken's treatment of the story of Aladdin.
Musker and Clements, they are like the only real directors that Disney has that they were coming off of Great Mouse Detective, the sort of slow creaking open of the door of getting back into feature animation, which that one, if you compare the animation, I actually really like Great Mouse Detective a lot. But if you compare the animation in it versus Aladdin, it's like it's good TV animation versus feature animation. Like the budget is incomparable for those two.
They were not given a big budget for that movie because it was thought to be like, this could be the last one we ever do. So have a little bit of money. But so it would be tedious if I were to list every possible element of all four versions of this story. So I'm just going through the slow growth of this. So Musker and Clements, they got rid of Jasmine's handmaiden, turned it into a tiger, and Abu the thief turned into a monkey. So they did like sort of animal-human swap on two characters.
Yeah. You need cute animals to sell them toys. So commercially, a very smart move.
They eliminated Aladdin's friends. And that got rid of two songs.
Oh, well, I like him as friendless. Like, he already's got a good friend anyway. Like,
he's got a monkey.
Yeah.
And the genie was no longer a black character as envisioned by Ashman. Roy Disney actually had reservations about putting a black character in the role of what's essentially a slave. Like, genie is a slave.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, that is a thornier. I didn't even think of that until then.
Yeah, and I really
wonder. Makes it a lot more loaded.
I do wonder, I have not seen the new live action movie yet, but can you see that baggage on the screen? Like, oh no, Will Smith is a slave.
Yeah, he's like, well, could you free me? I am a slave. That's a boy. Yeah. Did not think of that.
But that was a smart idea by Roy Disney. Maybe we shouldn't have a black slave in this fun movie for kids. So when the genie changed from black to, I guess, indiscriminate race, Musker and Clements pitch Robin Williams as the voice of Genie. And I will say, watch Lindsay Ellis's video about the Williams-Disney controversy about the Genie. We'll talk more about that later. But real celebrities were not hired to do animated movies.
Yeah.
Williams was a viable celebrity after things like Good Morning Vietnam and Hook especially, like the previous year's Hook. Like, he was a megastar.
Well, and to kids, too. I mean, obviously, Williams got his start in the 70s as a stand-up and as Mork. And probably for a good decade there, he thought, like, I'm Mork forever, aren't I? Like, I'm just always going to be Mork. But he's just... There are things you can complain about Robin Williams. Like, he did some hacky stuff. He was definitely guilty of stealing stand-up material early in his career, though he made a point to pay back people and give them the money, like, hey, I'm sorry, look, I'll write you a check. I'm sorry I stole it. So he did do that, but he seems like he was a really great guy who, you know, even if you could say, like, you thought his comedy was bad at some points, he was an electric performer, especially for children. Like, I knew who Robin Williams was when I was 10, and I wanted to see the movie for him.
Oh, yeah, me too. This is before, like, I'd even like Hook. I just knew I liked Robin Williams. The genie is no longer black. Musker and Clements wanted him to be the genie because they're like, he is the perfect voice of the genie. He can do a bunch of impressions. He can do a lot of improv. He is just a very strong performer, a strong comic performer. And in that Lindsay Ellis video, this was at a time where it's like, you think of the character first before the celebrity. celebrity you hire.
Mm-hmm.
Like, now it's like, let's get Steve Carell the voice of Squirrel. Why not?
Yeah.
He's available. He's a big deal.
Well, nobody, I mean, it changes from studio to studio, but the most lazy ones are, like, let's say the Emoji Movie. They just, they have a list of people, and they're like, what would be funny to hear coming out of that? And the animators will deal with that shit later. It feels way more executive-driven than animator-driven. Like, this, the choice for Williams was animator-driven, while meanwhile, the second you hear T.J. Miller's voice, you're like, yeah, they just said, we need a T.J. Miller type. Is T.J. Miller free?
He was available. Yeah.
Yes. Back then, he was. Now, he's, like, going to jail or whatever.
That's good. That's good for all of us.
Yeah, we're safe. It's a safer society with T.J. Miller
in jail.
The
streets are safe. Yeah, Muster and Clements admitted, like, we were setting ourselves up to fail in a way, because we wanted Genie to be Robin Williams, and if he wasn't, we'd be screwed, because the character was based on him. They did tests where they were animating the Genie to existing stand-up bits.
Those pencil tests are amazing.
Yeah, they're really cool.
You absolutely see the spirit of Genie right there, and it I think my mom even said when we were kids going to the movie, she's like, this is the perfect person to animate. Like, he is just so full of energy and constant bits that he needs to transform into other cartoon characters to make these bits work even better. And it's so such a natural marrying of actor with role. Arabian Nights, like Arabian days, more often than not, are hotter than hot in a lot of good ways.
You've worked hard for what you have, your money, your assets, your 401k, and home. Isn't it all worth protecting? Nearly one in four consumers have been a victim of identity theft. LifeLock Ultimate Plus helps protect your finances with up to $3 million in reimbursement. LifeLock alerts you to identity threats you might miss. And if your identity is stolen, your dedicated U.S.-based restoration specialist will work to fix it. Let LifeLock help protect what you've worked so hard for. Save 25% off your first year on LifeLock Ultimate Plus at LifeLock.com/aware. Terms apply.